Earlier this year, we had a local news team interview us about this system. And there's this one instance where this mother is saying that, yeah, my daughter just got her learner's permit, and she loves this system and she depends on this system. And I thought, at first I thought, hey, that's great. You know, we're getting somebody who really thinks this is a good thing. But the struggle I have as a traffic engineer is like, you know, if I remember right, I think the word was depend or rely on this system. And to me, that translates to regulatory device. It tells me when I can do something. The other issue that I'm struggling with as a traffic engineer with these types of systems is the whole concept of the sign definitions in EMETCD. Drivers for the most part recognize the definition of a sign. So a regulatory device, a stop sign, it tells you specifically what you can do. A yield sign, a traffic signal, a railroad crossing warning device, it tells you specifically this is what you have to do. It's regulatory, speed limit. Warning signs are just telling you, hey, this condition might be present, be aware, and react accordingly, right? Or another way to look at a warning sign is it's giving you supplementary information to make a better decision as a driver. The problem is that in this case, for this system, is that the stop sign, again, we have the roll-through problem. We're still experiencing a higher percentage of roll-throughs than I would like, you know, when there's no conflict. So the stop sign is almost like a warning device. And then the warning sign on the opposite side of the intersection that tells the driver when a vehicle is approaching, when it's flashing, that becomes almost like a regulatory device. So it's almost like drivers have blended or swapped definitions of the METCD. And, you know, for peers, traffic engineers, you know, it's like you struggle with that. One thing that was kind of interesting in phase one is we found that in the after period when the system was installed, that there were more roll-throughs than before the system even existed. And so we thought, gee, this is a really bad problem because we've actually increased the number of roll-throughs or the percentage of roll-throughs at this intersection, which any good traffic engineer would say that's a bad thing. In phase two, we were able to get the after period percentage of roll-throughs down to be less than it was in the before condition. So even though we're experiencing a higher percentage of roll-throughs than we would like, it's actually less than before the system was even installed. The good news is that when there was a conflict, meaning the driver on the minor approach knew there was a vehicle approaching from one of the directions, that roll-through percentage went down to less than 1%. So it was very effective that drivers recognizing that, hey, there's a conflict coming up. The other thing that we were successful at was in both phase one and phase two, the driver on the major approach, they all reacted approximately the same way. We reduced their average speed during a conflict by about 3.5 to 4 miles per hour. So getting back to like, well, how effective is this system at improving safety? Unfortunately, we don't have any crash data. That's one of the things that MnDOT is doing right now, is deploying these things all over the state, leaving it out there for several years, and then we can start getting some crash information. In the interim, the question is it effective in improving safety? And I would say the answer is yes. I think with the deployment of the MnDOT system over this year and the next couple of years, I think in a few years, 2 to 3, 4 years, we're going to have a lot more information collectively as a profession to make a better judgment. But so overall, I would say, you know, what's my opinion of the system today? I think it's a very good system. I think it's useful. ITS, I believe, is going to be critical as we continue to move into the future of towards zero death. We're in Minnesota. We're kind of getting to the point where we've harvested most of the low-hanging fruit, and the question is, how do we get to the top end of the tree? And I think ITS, these types of smart technologies, are going to be the next step in getting there. At least, I don't know if they're going to be the only way to get there, but I think they're going to be a major part of our next consideration. But, you know, so I think we're laying the groundwork today so that when we come back in our second wave of how do we get to the higher fruit, I think these ITS type solutions are going to be critical in helping us to accomplish our goal for towards zero deaths.